On December the 8th, 1957, there was a heavy snowstorm in New York. 10 elderly jazz musicians struggled to make their way through the drifts to a TV studio on 10th Avenue. One of them, the bass player, collapsed in the street and died 2 days later. But the others got through because they needed to be there. They wanted to be there to support Billie Holiday, who'd been their close friend and inspiration for more than 30 years.
It's a fantastic moment.
This is Guy Barker, trumpet player.
It's just like it's a jam session, and Billie Holiday's right in the middle there, living and breathing and playing this incredible music.
My man don't love me. He treats me oh so mean. My man, he don't love me. He treats me awful mean.
The thing about Billie Holiday with her musicians, always, all the way through, she romances them, is what they say.
This is Julia Blackburn, author of the most recent Billie Holiday biography.
She romances the band, and she was perfect for having always been one woman in the company of 5, 10, as many men as wanted to be playing or to be around her. Because you see how she's the centre of it, and how she's absolutely got eyes for each one in turn.
I mean, the thing about the saxophone is it is your voice. You sing through the instrument. Every tenor saxophone player sounds different. Even if I played the same saxophone mouthpiece and reed as Ben Webster, I wouldn't sound like Ben Webster. And also, to make music on this instrument, you have to use your whole body. And the note starts with your breath, starts inside you. You know, so you've just replaced your vocal cords with this lump of brass.
When Lester Young comes in, it's almost feline, isn't it? It's like a cat being very, very gentle, very careful, stepping each way. And Billie Holiday is completely wrapped up in every soloist who plays. She's following, she's hanging on to every note. There's a kind of knowing look when Lester Young starts playing, like, I just know this is going to be great. Oh, look, and there's, it's almost like huge respect you see in her face.
And you have to imagine, you have to see that he's not well. This tall, stooping man with orangish hair, green eyes, he's there in his carpet slippers. On his very last legs, he's going to die before Billie does. But there's a kind of sweetness and a hopelessness in him that comes straight across.
He was really copied, wasn't he? I think at the end of his life, everyone suddenly got hip to the way he played and everyone was copying him. And he was the original voice and he couldn't get a gig, you know. I mean, all this stuff, the social context of these musicians and the drug problems, alcohol problems, you know, it's a really hard life, and it's no wonder they kind of came off the rails. Whew.
It's beautiful, isn't it? It's understated. And
this is the singer, Jacqui Dankworth.
What's the word? Less is more, kind of playing. Beautiful. That's Lester Young, of course, who was her dear friend. And watching her when she's listening to that, I mean, obviously she's high as a kite, but it's almost like a language she understands.
He wears high-draped pants, stripes of yellow. He wears high-draped pants, stripes of yellow. But when he starts in to love me, he is so fine and low.
The accompaniment behind her is just beautiful. It's actually quite a rare thing, I think. I think players nowadays don't find that so easy to do, to find the spaces and play something that's just so delicate but perfect behind a singer and also heartfelt, you know, listening to her, responding to her.
But when he starts in to love me, he is so fine and low.
A lot of it is egoless, you know, they're playing so beautifully in terms of what the song needs, you know, which I think she really digs.
Playing the trombone is Vic Dickenson.
With Dickenson, he is a black man who looks like a white man. And what was so important with the role of jazz was that it unified that terrible racial divide. And that's the part of the poignancy of these kind of meetings, is because of what they've been through in racial America.
Cleo Laine, who was born in 1927, knows all about this.
It's amazing, really, that I was... You can see what colour I am. I'm pretty pale. But because they knew that I had a black ancestry, I was treated as if I was black in this country. I worked at the Savoy and I had to enter by the kitchen and so on like that.
See, I think jazz musicians would have been great politicians because they kind of saw the unbelievable ridiculousness of the situation that was going on. You'd all go and play the music together.
And then comes Gerry Mulligan.
He's playing baritone sax, Gerry Mulligan. I mean, you can tell as well that he's younger than everyone else on this date. He looks like he's 11 or something. But he's obviously kind of more hip to the bebop revolution that's kind of taking place. And he's playing it much more kind of virtuosic. It's a big instrument, the baritone saxophone. It takes a lot of puff to fill one of those.
He's fantastic. He's in this dog-toothed sports jacket. He kind of looms, doesn't he? He looms over them all, and he is a very big-bodied man who, most of the time, when he plays, he bends forward, his eyes are closed, and it's a classic jazz thing, isn't it? He starts, and then he disappears into the music and in the concentration of the music. And Billy, even though he's got his eyes closed, she's got her eyes open, and she's keeping him going.
All of the musicians here, they're from an era where they were all around playing in the 30s and the 40s, and here they are right at the end of the 50s. And right in the middle of it steps forward this young man who's just making a name for himself as like a star on the West Coast. Because suddenly there's a change, there's a gear shift at that moment. And it's interesting that it should happen with the young man in the crowd, you know, Gerry Mulligan.
Love made Billy drink and gamble, and it made her stay out all night long, and it made her do things that she knew was wrong. But it's not just the love of the one of the many men that she was involved with over her life. It was also, she was a person who was in search of love, and she also was somebody who needed love, and who had been, and if you know about her childhood, you know that it's a miracle that she got through at all. But the fact of singing was what made her strong. When she wasn't singing, she was timid, she was shy. But the moment she starts singing, she's transformed.
Love will make you do things that you know is wrong.
Coleman Hawkins plays that fantastic solo, and Coleman Hawkins was a master musician. He also played the cello, you know. But what's glorious about that is Gerry Mulligan just hanging on to every note that Coleman Hawkins is playing, and you can hear him like, well, you know, you're amazing. And I think that's a lovely moment as well. You know, the kind of respect and admiration all the musicians seem to have for each other there is great.
What we know about Billie, but that's with many of her men, her people, is that they did what was called a little light housekeeping together. They had a romance. But the problem was, as a black woman in the music world, being the woman making all the money, being the one with the power, as it were, to have the person she would marry or the person who she would have standing beside her, she chose thugs.
Well, she was probably recreating her childhood because she grew into prostitution, didn't she?
The whorehouses in Baltimore were her place of... Those were her paradises. Those were her place of rest and hope, if you like, because already then she had her voice. She says, "Hell, I realised I could make more money standing up than lying down." It's a very Billie Holiday statement, which meant she could make her living singing and not in prostitution.
You know, Roy Eldridge just comes in and just plays that barnstorming, amazing solo. And he's an incredibly important trumpet player. Somebody once likened it to a relay race. Louis Armstrong held the baton, and Louis handed it to Roy Eldridge. And Roy Eldridge handed it to Dizzy Gillespie. So Roy Eldridge is that bridge between the traditional sound of the music and its first great soloist, and onto the father of the modern jazz trumpet player.
He's a fearless trumpet player, isn't he? I mean, that's extraordinary to play with that passion. You've got to believe in those high notes. If you don't believe in them, they won't come out.
What I say in my book is Roy Eldridge is next. He wears a striped shirt and a broad-brimmed hat. He pushes the trumpet notes higher and higher, and it's as if he might burst from the effort. Billie is there as a gentle, smiling presence, and at one point he catches her eye for approval just before he takes the note to their final squealing heights. "Stand up, little brother," she used to say to him. "Stand up. You're small enough as it is." Very Billie.
I think these people come along, don't they? It's a bit like, you know, Miro or Picasso or something. Every now and again, someone comes along, like Ornette Coleman. I mean, you know, they come along and they completely change the direction of music in a way because they're original voices.
Now they're making this sort of feeling that we are getting close to the end. We're heading towards our golden section, you know.
treat me right, baby, and I'll stay home every day. Just treat me right, baby, and I'll stay home night and day. But you're so mean to me, baby, I know you're gonna drive me away.
The last years of Billie Holiday's life read like a movie script with a rather grim ending. Gangsters, drug enforcement officers, crooked promoters and agents all took advantage of her frailty. In the end, the ravages of booze and drug abuse brought her to a Harlem hospital, where she died just 18 months after this recording session.
She couldn't sing in New York, could she? They banned her from singing in New York. She took away her her license to sing, yeah. The public don't care whether you're accepted by the powers that be or not. It's the same, it's still the same. You know, you can behave absolutely disastrously and badly and the public will still come and see you because they like what you do.
Just treat me right, baby, and I'll stay home night and day. But you're so mean to me, baby, I know you're gonna drive me away.
I think it's interesting that you treat me right, baby, and I'll stay home night and day, because you always think this image of Billie Holiday is that she was endlessly the wild woman, endlessly the boozer or the drug addict, all this kind of very, very dense mythology around her. But actually at this time, she was longing for domesticity and she wanted to adopt children. She couldn't have children, but she tried to adopt a child and that went wrong. So that it's a promise that she would have liked to have kept.
I want a beautiful home. I want kids. And so, and I want to be able to have my own club. I want a little place to hold maybe 150, 200 people. Very cozy, you know, just all my friends and anybody else who wants to come. That's what I want.
Love is just like a faucet. It turns off and on. Love is like a faucet, it turns off and on. Sometimes when you think it's on, baby, it has turned off and gone.